And then this way, because I know Giacomo's presentations. Speaking of which, where are your slides?
Do you have slides or anything?
Yes, I sent it to you yesterday.
Okay, so well, I'll connect it to my computer then. And we'll, it will run it to mine.
So in the meantime, I can tell everybody.
Giacomo will continue with the introduction to the conference while we get his slides up. we'll get the event rolling.
No, okay. So this is not very Bitcoin focused, but the reason I don't have my belt is that yesterday I picked another guy's backpack instead of mine from the flight. So I had a few choices right now.
Oh boy!
Yeah. And so the first choice was to use a USB cable to keep my pants on. That was debated by other speakers, but it was not optimal. The other choice was to show you my wasabi underpants, which will trigger a lot of the Scamurai people. So there was no good solution. But luckily, I found the jiu-jitsu card of this guy. So this guy was also a jiu-jitsu champion. So that's not the best guy you want to steal the backpack from. But anyway, I think I will be fine. So. First of all, the reason that Tone received my presentation just earlier yesterday night is that, as always, I have a hard time finding the presentation topic until the very day before. And in this, as always, my go-to solution to find the topic for the presentation is fighting with people on Twitter. So you have it?
Yeah, I have. I have to change. Maybe duplicate screen? I have too many monitors.
So in this case, I was fighting about the concept of censorship. Some of you may know that there is the current debate about Bitcoin censorship. Okay. Right. So.
By the way, the way Giacomo does his presentations, like the day before, is similar to how we do the agenda for this event. Like, all the speakers are, like, texting me, like, for weeks, when is the agenda? I'm like, usually the day before. Because, like, people switch around, people get sick, people miss their flights because there was incidents in Las Vegas. How many of you got stuck at the airport yesterday for, like, 2 hours? How many of you's plane got diverted? Yeah, this is a rough, it's been a rough week here in Vegas for unfortunate incidents. But, yeah, go on. Oh, let me see if this works.
Does it?
It should. It vibrates.
So this is a zero knowledge conference. You only know it. Okay, it's working.
It's working.
Okay. So, okay, the title of the presentation is this censorship? I was fighting on Twitter yesterday with Kalle.
Only yesterday?
Only yesterday. This is yesterday with Kalle. And, well, I never fight with people except for yesterday. He tried to sell me the JPEG of this discussion, but I just right-clicked it. And basically, what is this fight about? This fight is about something that happened recently. Last week, actually, in South Carolina, some people that are here today as well, and you will see them on stage, were launching a new mining pool called Ocean. One of them is not here on stage, is Jack Dorsey, but the others are. Bob will be on stage, I will be on stage, Luke will be on stage, and others like Mechanic. First of all, I'm completely unbiased about this. Yes, it's true that I was at the presentation, but except for that, it's true I'm a very small investor, but except for that, it's true I am in the board of that company. It's true they are sponsoring this conference, to be honest. But except for that, I will try to be as unbiased as possible. So this pool started. They have a few features like transparent block template. You can see the block template before you put your work in. Non-custodial payout for miners above some threshold. And a very ambitious roadmap to something like Stratum V2 and Lightning Network payout. So it's very cool. But people don't like to focus on cool things because there is not much drama in cool things. So this was mostly the discussion the days after that. No, don't censor my dick butts. So what is this about? This is about basically the fact that this pool is using another implementation of Bitcoin Core, a fork of Bitcoin Core maintained by the main developer of the pool, Yuk Dashir, and this implementation is expanding the mempool filters of Bitcoin Core to some other anti-spam measures. I will discuss all of these later to explain exactly what I mean. But my main focus is not about what is happening technically. My main focus is about the use of the word censorship. You may think that only people that look like these are using the word censorship, you know, like typical shitcoiner guy, but or girl, or I mean, whatever. But that's not true. Even people that are friends, and I think that the people that I technically respect, are using the word censorship. For example, in this debate, there is you are stuck with this. Okay. In this debate, there is Peter Todd, who, of course, is a legit guy because he was a speaker at Unconfiscatable. And you know that Tone only picks legit guys as speaker. No, I'm joking. There are a lot of shitcoiners here. But anyway.
They usually turn shitcoining after they speak here.
Right.
We've had a long history.
But Peter is a good guy. But he's using the term censorship, speaking about mempool filtering of stuff, which I find very triggering, because I think that's a very serious terminological confusion. And indeed, many people are basically objecting, like other core developers are saying, there's no censorship of anything. This is just the mempool rules and the consensus rule. There is no censorship. And to be clear, I'm not making the case that Peter is technically wrong about the usefulness of this mempool filtering, because there are other people that I respect, like Andrew Postra, wrote a beautiful message about the fact that there is no sensible way to prevent people from storing arbitrary data in the witness without incentivizing even worse behavior and non-breaking legitimate use cases. So even people that I respect, and I think I may even agree with this, and disagree with Luke about this, but the main point is that calling this censorship is creating a huge, huge terminological problem and a huge confusion about what even means to be censoring something. In particular, for example, the same people that are complaining about censorship of digbots in blocks mined by Ocean are the same people that are cheering for other mining pool, for example, Luxor. Luxor created one block which was 4 megabytes big, and in this block, Luxor excluded many, many legit Bitcoin transactions in order to put in this Bitcoin transaction with Digbots or Wizard or whatever that was not paying any fee to the workers. So this mining pool censored a lot of legit transaction, because the things they actually included were paid to them and not to the workers of Bend. So is this censorship or is that censorship? I think, here Grumbus is also using the quotes, because this is not censorship either. This is just another way to select transaction. Ocean is selecting transaction based on the technical merits of Knot's implementation, while Luxor is selecting transaction based on the fact that spammers are paying them of Ben to select transaction, robbing the workers. So it's still not censorship, it's just selection. But let's go away from a moment from this Ocean drama. Let's take like a larger view here. Just 1 week ago, there was this other discussion about censorship. Oh yeah, sorry, well, this is just, so maybe you can think that the reason that I don't call Ocean's block transaction selection censorship is because I dislike ordinals and inscription. That's true. I think they are retarded. This is a shameless plug of my talk at BTC Prague, which is titled Ordinals Are Retarded. If you haven't seen it, I suggest you to see it, because I think I made the case that they are retarded in a very technical sense. So this is not an insult. This is a technical consideration. Watch the talk and you will understand. But even if we just ignore this retarded thing for a while, let's just discuss censorship in Bitcoin in general. There is another debate from last week, which is this other mining pool, F2 pool, that was discovered. It was not clear, it was not transparent about that, but somebody discovered that they were excluding from the blocks all the mempool transactions that were included in an OFAC sanctioned list. So when some user discovered that even if this transaction were paying fee, this pool, F2 pool, was excluding the transaction. So somebody called them out, And Chun said, you know, I have every right not to confirm any transaction from Vladimir Putin and Xi and Xi Jinping, don't I? People disagreed with him, and so he said that we will disable the transaction filtering patch for now. Notice how he's using the term filtering and not censoring, and I will go back to this. Until the community reaches a more comprehensive consensus on the topic. So it's like there is a lot of debate about the fact that we want to actually censor Vladimir Putin or Xi Jinping from Bitcoin, and we are waiting for this debate to end. That's not true. I mean, the main point of Bitcoin was to make possible for Adolf Hitler to send money to Osama bin Laden. That was the stated goal of Bitcoin. But anyway, some people, I mean, when Chun understood that this debate is actually already over, he deleted all the tweets, so you can only find screenshots right now. Is this censorship, deleting your tweets? I don't know, maybe self-censorship in this sense. But let's go on. And I found another, so what you know about anti-maximalist, right? So there are shitcoins, and there is a reaction to shitcoin, which is called Bitcoin maximalism, which is somebody saying, I mean, I don't like shitcoins, don't rug pull me, and don't lie about blockchain technology. And then there is the reaction to the reaction, which is our people that are banking on the fact that every time there is an opinion, you can actually bank on the contrarian opinion. These guys are the anti-maximalists. And I just read, also last week, one of the best uses of the word censorship ever from an anti-maximalist. In this case, this is the guy that wrote an article, The Culture of Bitcoin Culture. And there is this beautiful, there are two beautiful passages. The passage goes like, so when I joined Blockstream, I was basically presenting my idea about the fact that NFTs are actually good and self-custody is actually bad. But I was looking forward to having interesting debates, defending my nuanced views, while learning the more sophisticated critiques and perspective of my colleagues and peers at other Bitcoin companies. In practice, that never really happened. Mostly I was politically ignored, like a fart on a Zoom call. This is beautiful. This is like Blade Runner, you know. Everything is like a fart on a Zoom call. It's beautiful. But later in the article, this guy is saying, for a community that is theoretically funded on a shared philosophy of censorship resistance, the Bitcoin cultists are remarkably eager to suppress dangerous idea. So basically, people ignoring me because my ideas are as interesting as a fart on a Zoom call are censoring me if they don't debate my idea. So you can see that now the point, that the sentence censorship resistance, the word censorship is basically completely desemantized. There is no shared meaning to it. And I think it's worth it to discuss a little bit. For example, another good example, Bitcoiners are now very, very passionate about Nostr. I also am. I don't like the technology very much. I think it will never scale. It will never remain decentralized. But the movement is great. The ostrich is great. The purple color. I love the movement, even if I'm skeptical about the technology. Still, on Nostr, some people started to think, okay, but what happens if we start to receive posts with child pornography? Okay, that's no problem. The relays will just filter them out. Okay, but then what if the relays will filter out information about vaccines and hydrochlorine because it's not socially acceptable? So you see, it's not as trivial. If you go one way, I mean, censorship resistant is a very, very hard choice to make because it means censorship resistance. So is a relay selecting what? There was a moment in which Nostr was full of Chinese porn bots. And was that censorship to remove them from relay? That's an interesting question. Nostr was created also was also funded in a way by Jack Dorsey that was previously the head of Twitter. And Twitter was at the center of many debates, also among Bitcoiners, on a supposed censorship. And now everything is solved because finally free speech maximalist Elon Musk took it over, and now there is no censorship anymore. Wrong. This is a tweet by Elon Musk that said, by free speech, I simply mean that which matches the law. I'm against censorship that goes far beyond the law. If people want less free speech, they will ask government to pass laws to that effect. Therefore, going beyond the law is contrary to the will of the people. So even now, I mean, there is a lot of confusion here, right? Is the government always the will of the people? Is the will of the people always right? I mean, if we are in a park and there is a girl and four aggressive men, well, that is very sexist. Let's do the opposite. There is a good-looking boy like me in a park and four very, very aggressive women, and they want to rape me. So locally, the will of the people is four against one. They will rape me. But that's not just. That's not ethically correct. Because, I mean, I should decide over my body, not the will of the people. So there's still a lot of confusion. Elon Musk is not exactly the most consistent free speech philosopher we have out there. So let's move to something else. Bitcoiners knew about we had the problem with the concept of censorship even way before. You remember this man? This man was claiming two things. One, the thing that really triggered him was the fact that eliminating discussion about block size increase in different Bitcoin implementation by Reddit, subreddit Bitcoin, that was censorship. So I would say that 99% of Roger's crusade against Bitcoin and Bitcoin Core and for Bcash and everything was because it was censored on Reddit. And many people were answering, no, we are not censoring. We made a policy. You can still open another subreddit. And indeed, he did, /BTC. But if you stay on mine, I will give the rules for my Reddit. You can still go elsewhere, but if you stay on my Reddit, this is the rule that you can criticize because maybe you don't think it's a smart rule or you don't think it's an effective rule, but it is the rule. It's not censorship. You can still talk, and in fact, he did talk. Oh boy, he did talk. But there was also the point that Roger was also making the point that Bitcoin enforcing the block size that Satoshi Nakamoto included as part of the consensus is censorship. So there were a lot of speeches. I remember Scaling Bitcoin Canada 2015, and there was this other guy, Reason, saying that Blockstream employees were censoring Bitcoin by forbidding 10 megabyte blocks instead of one. So is that censorship? Is your node enforcing a block size on the blocks of Bitcoin a form of censorship? That was the case stated by that. So you see, there is a lot of confusion. So let's go back to the main topic. Is this censorship? Let's try to approach this point from a very broad kind of thing. So another shameless plug. I try to discuss this a little bit in another speech of mine, but very briefly. It's called Money Laundering is Beautiful in Baltic Honey Badger. This is a wrong screenshot. The actual title of the speech was Good Morning, Money Laundering is Beautiful. But anyway, I have this screenshot here. And I just did make some few words about censorship, but I didn't enter any merit. So I will today. So one problem you may have with my attempt to define censorship is that you can say, okay, censorship is just a word. As long as we agree on it, there is no problems. This can be censorship, this can be censorship or not. Who cares? I think we should care, because even if we can define words as an agreement, as a consensus among us, this consensus must have some characteristic to be useful. First, it must be internally consistent. So if you say that Bitcoin Core filtering out transactions that pay a high fee but have more than 80 bytes of op return from the mempool, if you say that is not censoring, then you cannot consistently say that Bitcoin nodes, which is filtering out transaction with 42 bytes of op return, is actually censorship. You see, it's not logically consistent. You should use the same sentence for both or for neither, right? So if you say that imposing a mempool filter like Bitcoin Core does, so all the mempool, all the pool out there, they do it, and as Knots in Ocean does, if that's censorship, then even imposing consensus about block validity is a form of censorship. It's just that you are censoring blocks that maybe there may be a block that will pay 1 million Bitcoin as a fee, but this block will be 5 megabytes large. So your node will just exclude this block from mempool and from everything else, from your chain. Is this censorship? So you see, the main problem is to be internally consistent. But even when you are internally consistent, You must also be externally consistent with everything else that we have said in the past about that word. So, for example, let's say that every kind of choice that Bitcoin Core makes when we filter transactions, blocks, for standardness, for validity, for all the other characteristics, let's call all of that censorship. Okay, we can, but then we cannot say anymore that Bitcoin is a tool for censorship resistance. Actually, what Bitcoin becomes in this version of the word is a tool for enforced censorship, basically, for enforcing censorship. Everything Bitcoin does is to exclude some transactions that are not valid and to include others that are valid. That's the whole point of the blockchain of Bitcoin and everything. So even we say, either we say that the whole point of Bitcoin is censorship, but that's basically a meaningless use of the term, or we have to find a term that is consistent with the fact that we want censorship resistance. The other point is that something must be maximally consistent over time. There is the trick, especially used recently by the woke culture, but even in the past by many many totalitarian regimes, to change very fast the meaning of the words. So words are consensus, and we agree about that. But if I change the word if I change the meaning of a word very, very, very often, then you are forced to basically follow me and to stay up to date with my arbitrary decision. So that gives me power. So we decide that today the word canary is racist because it's yellow, like an Asian guy. So that's racist. So in order to know exactly that you are not racist, you have to follow my newest article and to follow my new terminological decision. So a better way to define words, if defining words in a way that is maximally consistent over time. We know the languages have to change, but it's better we don't change too fast. So what were we using as a term for censorship, as a meaning for censorship a few years ago in Bitcoin, should hopefully be the same terminology we apply today about censorship. Changing one day to the other. So 1 week ago, Bitcoin Core eliminating from the mempool 81 byte operator was not censorship. Now Bitcoin nodes eliminating that is censorship. That's not consistent over time. We are just changing the definition on the fly. And of course, it's also better if a definition is maximally consistent over people. So if more and more people agree, because otherwise you are talking with yourself. If you talk with, if you use a terminology that nobody else has used, then you're basically out of consensus. Like if you run a shitcoin that nobody else uses. You're free to do that, but it's stupid. You are losing money because nobody else is understanding you. So let's go to Wikipedia. I find the Wikipedia, so if we want to clarify something, let's use Wikipedia, right? It was so comical when yesterday I tried to use Wikipedia to define censorship. Well, first of all, because, I mean, censorship is a very serious topic, like Socrates was killed for his speech in Greece, so people has been killed for censorship. People have been sent to gulags for censorship. Yet what Wikipedia authors selected for censorship was basically David's peewee covered by, it's probably not the most epic choice they could do. Basically, it's like Dick Bucks all again. Like, this was the main problem of censorship. But the really funny thing is that this article about censorship was flagged because it contained wizard word vague phrasing that often accompanies biased or unverifiable information. Such statements should be clarified or removed. And then, the definition of censorship here is any suppression of information conducted by governments, private institutions, and other controlling bodies. So private institutions like Wikipedia, if they remove any information, that's censorship. But they should remove some words because they are whistle words and they should be removed. But link above, Wikipedia policy concerning censorship. See, Wikipedia is not censored. So it's a mess, right? It's a mess. They don't even know what they're writing about. They are going short circuit in their brain while they write down the article. Let's move to Wiki Dictionary. It's a little bit better. So the first meaning for censorship is the use of a state or group power to control freedom of expression or press, such as passing laws to prevent media from being published or propagated. And then historical, the role of the censor, which was a state magistrate in Rome. Basically, it was a guy in Rome that was basically was sending people to jail for speech. So that's a very, very clear meaning of the word censorship. A Roman state employee sending people to jail because of what they said. This is a very clear meaning for censorship. So we can have many, many. So the most trivial way that somebody, the most trivial criteria that somebody uses when they say censorship is basically bad versus good. So do I like dick butts? If yes, then filtering them out is censorship. If no, then filtering them out is not censorship. This definition doesn't scale very well across people and across time, because my tastes, in fact, of dick butts can change over time. I hope not. But also, my tastes can be different from yours across people. So this is not a very good way to define censorship or versus filtering, because nobody agrees that everything is bad. Maybe, F. Tupul think that Vladimir Putin sending money is bad. I may agree, but I can agree on other things. I mean, it's very vague as a definition. A second one can be global versus local. So there is somebody making the point that is like, so let's assume that I have a newspaper. Is it censorship if you send me a poetry and I don't want to publish that poetry on my front page because I don't like it? That's not censorship, right? So the distinction would be, if I actively prevent you from getting your shitty poetry everywhere, anywhere, that's censorship. If I leave you to the challenge to spread your poetry as far as you can, but I'm not allowing your poetry in my thing locally, that's not censorship. So this would be the argument. If a single block is excluding a transaction, that's not censorship. But if all blocks are, that's censorship. Still, that means that the consensus rules of Bitcoin are censorship, because everybody are enforcing them everywhere. So another possible meaning is active versus passive. So if I refuse to publish your poetry, I'm just passively refusing to do something for you. You are asking me to do something, and I say no. While the Roman guy throwing people in jail, he was actively going around searching for people to throw in jail. So this is possibly a little bit better, maybe, this definition, but still is not very clear. Let's try to improve. So this is very frequent. This is like a version of bad versus good, which is more democratically based. So if something is unpopular, then filtering out, that's good. That's not censorship. If something is popular, then filtering out, that's censorship. So that's the argument of people that say, if this stuff has a demand, a market demand, then you cannot exclude them from your node, because that's censorship. If there is not market demand, this is actually good. Which we basically go back to the four women in the park. So democracy, right? The rule of the majority. Something is good if more people agree that it's good. Or you can also have old versus new. For example, many debates about Twitter were the fact that I joined Twitter with some term of service, which is clearly stated. This term of service says that I can write the word vex without being immediately canceled and banned. If that changes over time, that's not fair, because I started to contribute my content to Twitter under some assumption, and now you are suddenly changing the assumption after I already contributed my content to you. So this is you see that we are going somewhere. This is a kind of objective definition of censorship, changing the rules ex post. Like, for example, Bitcoin Core was censoring op return over 42 bytes. Then Bitcoin Core changed the rule to allow 80 bytes, but Bitcoin Knots, that was a fork, did not. So in this case, it's a matter of expanding the filter definition, but it's still not censorship. There is also the idea of public versus private. So somebody says, if you are the government, and you're filtering out something, that's censorship. If you're a private company, that's not censorship. This is trickier than it seems, because actually, for example, in the case of Twitter, FBI agents actually went into the headquarters of Twitter to tell Jack Dorsey and others how they should manage some kind of Twitter filtering or bans or account restriction. So when a company, which is a for-profit private company, does something because they have the FBI agents inside the offices, is that public or private? I think it blurs the lines a little bit, right? The Twitter files showed us that the lines can be a little bit blurred. So maybe I am Elon Musk. I would like free speech, but then I also want to sell stuff to some countries. And people in those countries, they will go to jail if they say something. So maybe I have to review my stance, but not because I choose it, because there was a threat of violence from the state in some local place. So this is complex. Let's move to a more... So, for example, I'm a libertarian. I don't think that public versus private really makes any sense. I think that governments are just private circles that use this mythology to cover the fact that they are just taking resources from other people. It's like, I mean, you are in Sicily. Thank you. Yeah, okay, you can do it. Thank you. So you are in Sicily. One guy comes and says, I want your money. He's a private robber. But then if a guy comes and say, I want your money, but I represent the local society with Cosa Nostra, I represent the padrino, and this money is for your own protection, now it's not private anymore. Now it's public. It's basically a state. The Cosa Nostra, Repubblica Italiana, these are states. One is bigger, one is smaller. But Cosa Nostra has tax rate at 10%. Repubblica Italiana has 70%. So, I mean, they're not all equal, but still they are mafias. So a better distinction is violent versus peaceful. One could say that if I come to you and I aggress you physically, if you say something, that's censorship. And if I don't do that, but I just use my own property to select if I want to reproduce your information or not, so if I only rule on my newspaper or on my walls of my house for your graffiti, you are Banksy, you want to do art on my wall, man, that's my wall. I decide if you do art there or not. If you are Banksy, buy a fucking house and do your art, but not on mine, right? So this is violence versus peaceful. But the problem is that how do you define violence? In order to define what is violence and what is not violence, you have to have a theory of property. And the theory of property is quite complex. You have basically to know what is yours and what is not yours. You have to have that well defined. So you go back to a distinction between something that is just and something which is not just. So you go back to the start, which the fact that these guys here, after a lot of nuances and discussion, go back to the same starting point of bad versus good, also plays into another speech that I gave, which is basically this. Which is this, and you can see that on YouTube as well. So the problem of Bitcoin with midwits. So another shameless plug. But anyway, in order to let's do an experiment. I still have a few minutes. Let's do an experiment. Let's try some example, and let's see if we can be internally consistent with the definition, externally consistent with other things that we know about the world, maximally consistent over time and over people. For example, you turn on a laptop, you git clone Bitcoin Core, so you write Bitcoin Core git clone, and you run it, you compile it in C++, and you run it. So if you open the laptop, and it's not your laptop, and you enter the password in Linux, and the password is wrong, your information will be deleted, and you will not be able to access the information and to run Bitcoin. Is that censorship? Is that censorship? No, right? If you open the terminal and you write git clone, but then you don't write it right, you make a typo in git clone, your command will be ignored by the operating system. Is that censorship? No, it's a rule. Just create your own version of git that does differently. If you compile Bitcoin Core, but the things you say are not welcome in the compiler, because when you use the compiler, the compiler doesn't like your syntax because it's not C++. Is that censorship? No? Okay. You run Bitcoin Core with the wrong command. Bitcoin Core doesn't start. Is that censorship? No. Let's try to get a little bit more complex. So, cool. Okay. So your Bitcoin Core node starts and it connects with other peers. some peers, you don't even know that. You don't even look at that, but it does that automatically. Your node will receive information from some peers that are considered a spam because there are too many connection attempts. So basically, they are considered potential DDoS attack. So your node in the peer-to-peer part, they will blacklist. Oh, sorry, that's racist. They will blocklist, how I will say now. They will blocklist the IPs of other Bitcoin nodes when they misbehave in terms of timing of connection. Is that censorship? No? Okay, we're still good? So now, your Bitcoin Core will run, and when it runs, it will reject all the blocks violating the difficulty adjustment. So if somebody is trying to make a block that doesn't satisfy the difficulty adjustment, your node will just exclude it. Maybe this block pays a lot of fees, but it's not consistent with your selected difficulty adjustment. So it's not censorship, right? Let's do the same with blocks violating the issuance schedule. This block is cool, it follows the difficulty adjustment, but it gives you 23 million Bitcoin of fees or of issuance in the Coinbase. You reject that. Your node will reject that because that's the rule. So this is not a divine rule. It's not like that. Like Satoshi choose the supply schedule for an ethical necessity. He could have chosen 21 million, 23, 25, 42 would be even cooler, 69. It was on him arbitrary choice, and you are not just agreeing with that arbitrary choice because you want to stay in consensus with Bitcoin, and so you are excluding everybody else. This is not censorship. It's your node, your rules. You reject blocks that are violating the block size limit. This is still not censorship. Sorry, Roger. This is not censorship. This is just another rule, just like the difficulty adjustment. So now, you reject transactions that violate the script rules, so they are not using the correct signatures, not censorship. Now, this is trickier, because now you see a transaction that violated the dust limit in your mempool. So what does your Bitcoin Core node today, every one of your nodes right now, what does it do? They will eliminate the transaction from your mempool. If you are a mining pool node, this will eliminate the transaction from your block template. But this transaction is not violating the rules of the protocol. Indeed, if you find this transaction on the mempool, you will just delete it. But if you find it inside the block from somebody else, you will accept the block as valid. So this is not about validity of the blocks. This is about mempool policies. This makes it more censorship than the other? No. It's just another technical choice of your node. And all of your nodes are doing this. But somebody may say, okay, but nobody's paying for dust limit. What if your Bitcoin Core will see a transaction in the map pool that will violate the op return limit? So it will have 81 bytes of op return. Again, your Bitcoin Core node will reject it right now, all of your nodes, from your mempool. If you are a mining pool, it will reject it from your block template immediately. But if you find it in a block, then it will accept it as valid. And this transaction is not dust. It can pay a lot of fees. You can try to send today a transaction that is basically giving $1 million of fees, but has an op return with 82 bytes. This transaction will be excluded by your node and excluded by your block template automatically by Bitcoin Core. So if we move from Bitcoin Core and you go to Knot's version 25, which is what the mining pool I was referring before is using right now, the limit is moved from 80 bytes to 42 bytes. Is there something magical about the number 80 and 42 that makes this censorship and not the other one? Well, let's think about like consistency over like good versus bad. It depends. Somebody may consider this better, and there is a debate to be had about that. I'm not necessarily agree with Luke on this. Maybe it's better 80, maybe it's better 42. I think it's better 42 actually. But anyway, it's a debate about that. We don't have an agreement. Consistency over time. Well, Bitcoin Core used to filter transaction above 42. Then Bitcoin Core changed the policy, while another implementation that forked before didn't change the policy. Is that censorship? I don't think so. So let's move to now have to pull that install a patch that will exclude the transactions that are included in the OFAC blacklist, oh sorry, that's racist, blocklist, under threat of physical aggression. So these transactions are transactions that are forbidden globally. They are forbidden on bank accounts, on PayPal, everywhere the government can forbid them, they will try to forbid them. And if you are accused by the United States government to facilitate violation of OFAC lists, you are going to jail physically. So maybe F2Pool people really dislike Vladimir Putin alone, as they say. Or maybe there is a direct threat of aggression, physical aggression, if they include this transaction. So going over all the criteria that we used, physical aggression, like peaceful versus violent, and even like even bad versus good, because in a way that the main point about this patch is how do you know that the OFAC list is correct? Can you verify it? Do they have like an open source system that you know that if a transaction is included in that list, that's Vladimir Putin? Do you, even assuming that it's fine for you to censor monetary transaction from Vladimir Putin, do you really know it's him? Or you're just trusting a politician that is telling you something? And what happens if you don't trust the politician? It's just a matter of difference of opinion, or you risk to go to jail? The latter. So I think that this is a very good point to start to distinguish from filtering for technical reasons that we may disagree about and actual censorship resistance. Bitcoin cannot be considered censorship resistant for the first set of rules, because those define Bitcoin. Bitcoin is all these rules. Bitcoin cannot work without all these rules. Yes, it can work without this, arguably, or maybe even without this, but these are just parts of how Bitcoin works. Bitcoin cannot work anymore with these rules. If these rules are implemented, Bitcoin becomes PayPal. It's just a very inefficient version of PayPal. So this is not even my final form. The final form is not a patch that will exclude of a blacklist transaction from the mempool, but it will be another patch, version 2, that will exclude OFAC blacklist blocks from the blockchain. So even some other mining pool, even if some other mining pool includes an OFAC blacklist transaction, I will not just exclude it from my mempool. I will also exclude it from my blockchain, creating basically a soft fork, enforcing some kind of evil soft fork. So I have to finish with one thing. I am friend personally with Tone, last one. I am friend with Max Kaiser. He was a speaker here as well, so he cannot be a scammer, right? Because Tone only selects the best. I'm personal friend with him. I respect what he's doing about the educating against shitcoins in El Salvador. Shitcoins are bad, and education is a good tool to prevent people from getting scammed. But this, even if I'm a friend with a person, this is exactly censorship. Sorry, Max. Thank you.
All right, thank you, Giacomo. Wow, you got off the stage quick. Don't forget your other belt. Now you have two. Came with none, now he's got two.